pretty hard. SKT will be respecting away the rumble. They set up for with a first pick in game one. Tom Kench banned. Okay.
Okay.
Maybe signaling that an Ash pick is coming pretty early in this draft. The second ban, Kennen, told us that Rumble first pick was coming for SKT, so we'll see if this has something to do with Ash. This is the sort of game where SKT might leave up LeBlanc and Varus. You know, you could see them leaving up both.
I feel like LeBlanc is almost more likely for Varus to be banned away, but now Camille taken off the board, so that could just lead to the Varus ban by SK Telecom and leave the Rengar available.
I don't think you're worried about specifically the LeBlanc from Kuros. I think they would have banned Varus over LeBlanc or given up both.
Yeah.
Regardless, both champions now off the board. Still a lot of power available. Traditional first picks are gone, but something like Ryze could be reached for. The Ashe, like we said, with the Tom Kench ban makes a lot of sense. Probably going to be a first round top laner for Freak of Freaks in the second round here. Something like a Maokai to stop SKT double banning top again.
Well, Ashe is picked up, so what do you want to go for if you're SKT? The Grave's available for Peanut.
But Rengar also. And Rengar has been one that SKT have favored as well. You might just want to keep the confidence high with the Lee Sin. Now, Ashe Karma is the competed duo lane we see the most. We'll see the Graves taken away. So now if the Lulu is taken, you do have the losing lane matchup against the Karma, and you don't have the Wild Growth synergy or the disengage from Rengar. So I like this draft in that it doesn't really give Afrika many obvious wins on the blue side when it comes to the first round at least. And I'm just excited to see if we see a top laner selected here.
I still find it interesting that Wolf is not opting in for the Lulu when they know that the Rengar is available and likely going to be the jungle pick for Afrika. They still just keep going to this Karma, which is currently undefeated for him. So it is a very reliable pick for Wolf.
I think
but
if you just
still
go,
a little interesting to see.
If you just go for the pressure and stop the game being played at the pace that Afrika wants to be played at, you never really get to the late game team fights where Rengar can be a threat. The game was decided by a level 4 Rengar misplay, and after that didn't matter if they had the Lulu or not. And this time, because the Ashe was taken first, we're going to see SKT go for that Ezreal. Now, we have seen Talon from Afrika already. Kuro played it and looked great on it. And because they didn't take a support, Lulu will be banned now. I'm interested to see if they ban a second support or if they ban a mid laner towards side of Freaky Freaks, but it seems to be a little bit less pressure on the champion pools of Marin and Kuro so far in this draft. All relative, of course. There is two bans already from SKT towards Marin. What do Afrika want to focus for the solo laners of SKT?
They kind of bold to go for banning out Faker, so it seems like they might just try to pinch the top lane, give Marin an advantageous, run in that lane with the Nautilus for him.
Double bans towards champions that are both meta and strong against Karma. Seems like a Zyra is the likely take, although Kuro could just be flexing that support from Marin's side to Tucson's. While they haven't taken a top laner necessarily, the Nautilus, of course, is expected to be a top laner, but
could be flexed, yes.
Could be flexed. It's the sort of thing that Tucson loves to do, and strong into Karma in particular. So we'll see if they try and pull another fast one with the Nautilus support.
Maybe this is time for Tucson's favorite, his Aurelia support.
We've been seeing more and more early Vladimir's Achilleos, and we see it here blind picked. Kuzan was doing this in the series yesterday against KT, and okay, might have lost the series, but the Vladimir pick in isolation was very powerful.
He looked quite good against Pawn. Pawn did not play well in that series at all.
So let's see. If it's just going to be the Nautilus top, as you might expect, we're going to find out with the last pick. Kuro's been on form with this Talia. So we'll lock it in and try and roam on the Vladimir early before Vlad gets protobelt. And no, it will just be top lane Nautilus. Probably should have expected that given it's Marin. But given the matchup into Karma and how they flex the Camille, well, there was an outside chance we'd see something special for Marin in top. But it would have been a blind pick. Now SKT, they could just go on Maokai duty. Poppy with a bit more early game to be able to match pressure. They need some wave clear.
Yep, that will be the play. They go ahead and lock it in. So standard top lane matchup coming out here for Huni, picking up that Poppy. But yeah, Vladimir going back to high priority, and now Faker going to be picking it up for himself.
Sustained damage is the story on the side of SKT. Long team fights where Ezreal and Vladimir can kite sustain and get through fights seem to be exactly well suited for SK Telecom T1, whereas Nautilus and Taliyah, as solo lanes on the side of Afrika, let you know they want to go for early roams, early picks. Could be a devastating to bot lane turret dive, as we've seen so many different times with teams setting up with a ward behind a bot lane turret and making that big 8 to 10 minute play. Let's see if Afrika Freaks can really have a more steadying early game, because the early game was what propelled SKT to their big victory in game one.
Yeah, and a lot of that's, you know, going to come down to Spirit. How is he going to perform here right now in this matchup? Peanut looked so very strong on Lee Sin in game one, now going over to the Graves, one of Spirit's big picks. So if Peanut can get a lead, then maybe it all just comes tumbling down for Afrika Freaks yet again right off the bat.
AD carries reverse. This time it's Ezreal Judy for Bang, perhaps the best Ezreal in the world, although Deft had a day out yesterday that makes us still continue to wonder. Blind pick is dead, sadly, so we don't get Ezreal versus Ezreal in the LCK. Thanks, Riot, for that one. Still depressed.
No more Zeds either.
And only one Shen.
No two Shens.
Only one.
Nope. It can be only one, unfortunately.
No Shens in this game, even. Banned away.
Banned away. Shen's no fun, apparently. But, oh well, we still get some interesting matchups. We get Spirit coming back onto the Rift, trying to take down SKT. Let's see if we can do it. Let's get it into the Rift for game number two. Crowd is definitely filled in since game number one, 6 p.m., but easier for everybody to jump into the studio. So everybody showing up to show their support for their favorite team.
Speaking of everyone, Gank Brush established in the bot lane for Freak of Freaks.
Everybody minus Spirit.
He's got things to do. Rengar vs. Graze for the most standard of jungle matchups. You'll notice the Storm Raider Surge is definitely picked up on a lot of different sides when it comes to picks. That's a good drawing right
that
there.
That is a really good drawing of Hootie right there.
Very Hootie doesn't nice. See it, so he's nonplussed about it.
I hope he sees it at the end
meet.
Of the day. Yeah, if somebody handed it to him at the fan meet, that'd be pretty good. I'd love to see his reaction if he just happens to make that face.
People have been wondering about specifically, though, Achilles, the Storm Raider Surge on Graves, because Thunder Lords used to always be the pick there for the massive level 2, level 3 damage.
Yeah.
He just does so much damage with his autos that two autos usually procs the Storm Raiders, especially with a spell. And then you are in range for the consecutive auto. So, yep, it's a bit weaker when it comes to level 3 ganking, but Graves seems to be farming to 6 most times anyway, so perhaps not the biggest factor. Maybe a telltale sign that the Graves is going to be a bit more defensive is Marin's just being rude.
And just going to get as much of a lead as he can in this lane, so he goes ahead. Already gets one of the charges off the corrupting potion there for Hootie, so mission accomplished for Marin.
I wish with more of those mini games like the buckler that's thrown by Poppy, that if the enemy top laner picked it up, they get the shield. That would be cool.
That would be very interesting mechanic.
Although then the RNG would be a big factor for trades, so perhaps that would be a bad thing, but I can want what I want, Achilles.
Yeah. Pick up the Draven axe, and all of a sudden you just have that. Tom Kench.
But now in my head, champion. I have a Soraka with double whirling axes, and that's just amazing.
I don't know if this is a world that I want to live in. This sounds like an absolute nightmare.
As long as Soraka's not in the mid lane, I'm kind of happy with where the meta's at.
She's an ambulance that can now kill you.
The passive would certainly be very useful in that scenario.
Oh my god.
The Wambulance into killing people.
Constant HP back.
Alright, well, let's put that out of our heads for now. If we can. That's a bit like the whole
there we go.
Don't think of an elephant.
There
no,
you
I
go.
Can only think of elephants.
Riot, you just got a new minigame mode that you can push when Earth is down.
Oh, this is a nice pathing from Peanut. So he's gone. Skipped two small camps. He just wants to come around the back.
Wrap around. Tucson's already low. He's going to flash over the wall. Exhaust comes through, but end of the line is there. One more hit would do it, but the heal comes out from Kramer to keep him alive.
Well held from Kramer till the last auto attack was in flight. A bit like Shen ultimate from Smeb yesterday as the last bullet was in flight from Jin.
I mean, that's three summoners down, though. SKT don't have to invest any of their own, so still a lot of pickups coming through that bottom lane gank.
Knew that Kramer and Tucson want to try and pressure. Bang inevitably going to lose some of that wave pushing and controlled the wave well. good communication between Peanut and the bot lane. And we've actually seen as recent as the last series, you remember game one in SKT's last series was a scenario where Peanut tried to solo gank bot as Bang was holding the lane as Ezreal. Clearly a disconnect between the solo, between the duo lane and Peanut, whereas communication flow was much better that time around.
Yeah, seems like there's been a lot of work done here in the meantime. And, you know, every time I happen to walk through the SKT room, it seems like Koma is always sitting down with Peanut. He's always talking to Peanut. And it seems like that buildup has been paying off lately. Peanut's form is returning. He's communicating better with the team. It seems like Koma has given him a lot of one-on-one time, and it's really working out.
I said the other teams in the world wince when we talk about SKT improving. They are 11-1 in Korea. They've already taken down their most obvious close competition in KT Rollster twice this season.
I mean, we thought maybe that would change if Afrika came swinging out the gates, but they really suffered in game number one.
What I'm trying to say, Achilleos,
win this here and maybe even win the set, then you have to consider maybe Afrika is the next best competition.
I think game one kind of puts paid to some of those thoughts, given how kind of rolled over, but it is with Spirit this time, so maybe we adjust the narrative slightly. Level six is when things get exciting. Weaver's Wall has been probably the most exciting ability to track in recent weeks. We've seen so many creative terrain weavers. Well, it just hasn't been, you know, a pseudo Twist of Fate ultimate gap closure. It's been more about the wall and specifically walling away targets from Baron, from being able to kite out of engage. I've seen some great stuff from, specifically thinking of Kuzan and Kuro as some of the most creative users of the Tilia in recent weeks. So fun to see that Tilia again.
Yeah. He's already doing a pretty good job.
No summoners.
Yeah, too soon. He's going to get locked down. Tether coming through. Big burst of damage from the Graves. Helps take him down. Wolf actually finds the first blood. And Bang, not even able to really push forward and get the assist in.
He wasn't there, Achilleos. Right. That's the reason why the gank was so well obfuscated, is because it happened while Bang was still walking to lane. Karma just walked up, tethered, exhausted, and there was Peanut to pick up the kill. So another case where the communication between bot lane and the jungle has clearly improved for SKT. I mean, fitting in Peanut, it's the last piece of the puzzle. It seems like every other piece is exactly where it needs to be. We haven't necessarily seen the 1v1 battle between Marin and Huni that would perhaps crown Huni, given that, honestly, over the course of six games, he outplayed Smeb in their two series there. So taking down Marin as well would be beating the cream of the crop for Huni.
Yeah.
Competitive, though, at minimum.
And gonna try to get some nice vision control in this bottom lane. Clear up that control. So can spot out Peanut. He decides to wrap around for yet another gank. Meanwhile, Wolf, he's clearing out some wards. He's gonna have to sprint up the lane. Spirit locks him down with a bolo shot. Plant's coming through. Heal over the wall from Bang, keeping him alive for now. One more hit would have done it, but Wolf is able to make it out with his life. At least for the moment. Now Peanut getting jumped
watch
on.
Faker.
Wall coming through. Faker, the flash over the wall. Exhaust immediately comes down. He goes low. Has to enter the Sengreen pool. Won't get much more damage in for the pop on the Hemo Plague. And now SKT, they have to kite back. One more shot onto Peanut would do it. Faker gets rooted up. Doesn't have the pull. And he goes down. Tucson finds the
kill.
Meanwhile, Wolf falls over by the blue buff. Kuro picking that one up solo. Two kills on the board for Afrika Freaks. Good turnaround from them.
Could have been more. Kuro decided not to persist with going around the turret. Would just return to mid and push in the lane instead. Would have been tricky. Bang still had flash. Peanut was the one, but they may have communicated that his flash was up and it was too hard to lock him down. So a lot of action around the bot lane is won by the Afrika Freaks and won't have the same hail of objectives that SKT picked up in game one, but still good stuff. Bang's thinking about this.
Yeah, tosses out the True Shot Barrage. Another Mystic Shot lands. Oh, Bang! Doesn't want to go over the wall. So will not be chasing in for the kill, but Tucson.
He's up to 16 health, which when you think about health regen, he's probably at, what, 7? 8
yeah,
health?
He was really low. Arcane Shift guaranteed kill.
Oh, for sure.
So restraint being shown by Bang. Want to go to ham. That Spirit was nearby and doesn't want to just hand another kill over to Afrika Freaks. Killing Tucson would be great, but killing Tucson and then dying for it is not the greatest exchange for an AD carry.
And there's always two schools of thought with using your flash for a single kill on a support in laning phase. Given they've already seen attention in bot lane, what I imagine as we see Marn walk in. What I imagine was kind of the mental gymnastics there for Bang was, well, Marn didn't teleport in. I'm probably going to need that flash when the Nautilus shows up bot lane. So getting a single kill on Azir is probably not worth it. And speaking of Bang, CS advantage pretty severe in bot lane already. After the early visits from Pina, 30 CS-ish advantage over Ashe is Bang.
Faker really just getting hammered on by Kuro in these exchanges. The threaded volley's just chunking him out.
It's the cost.
So steadily.
It's the cost of running the Vladimir. Gets pushed in heavily in the early game. The roaming options are there for Kuro. Doesn't have Weaver's Wall for about 20 seconds, though. Full vision established by Afrika, so already Spirit coming into the jungle and their early movements are much improved on game one.
Yep, so Mowgli still having some stuff to work on, but has been, you know, looking pretty good overall for Afrika, you'd have to say. Maybe not the jungler you want to have start against the toughest opposition in the league, but overall still pretty good. Huni with the roam down, trying to get this pinch down onto Koro. Peanuts nearby, he's going to flash in for this one. Knocks him up with the Keeper's Verdict. Now Pinet arriving into the line, plus collateral damage. Takes him out. They find the kill. Control the hunt pop by Spirit, but there's just no way for him to walk into three members of SKT. Marn will get a lot of pressure down onto this turret in the meantime, but SKT just picking up a kill where they can.
SKT, once again, the communications around where the flash is up and down in bot lane got them Tucson when he used two summoners. Now got them Kuro, who had Ghost, didn't pop it. And that's why, even though there wasn't terrain for Huni to get the flash heroic charge, the ult was enough for the gap close from the rest of the members.
I mean, they get the kill, but they have to invest two flashes in order to do so. So really just paying a big price to alleviate that pressure from Faker in the mid lane, allow him to farm up freely, shove in, maybe get a recall.
How many junglers Helios have given up their early games to give some latitude to Faker?
Now Huni's involved.
It tends to work out for SK Telecom T1 when they relief pressure from Faker.
That definitely helps out quite a bit.
Deep Ward spots Spirit, so they know exactly where Rengar is on the jungle. Through three wards now.
Yeah.
Doesn't have ult though, so not the most fierce gank pressure.
I think you get a big seismic shove in from Kuro. Could maybe lead to something. Throws out the threaded volley, gets that Thunderlord's proc, just steadily chipping away at the Vladimir yet again.
That's bemoaning his lack of cooldowns. Teleport's coming in.
Yeah, TP's coming through. They're going to be looking for a dive on the bottom lane. Marn and Spirit wrapping around from behind. Tucson taking a lot of damage,
Wolf.
But it's going to be five members in the bottom side. Bang and Wolf in such a rough spot. Bang gets caught out, knocked up by the depth charge, and taken out as Kuro pops him with that threaded volley. And that should be first brick going over to Afrika. Wave's a little bit weak, but Marin's got plenty of HP. They'll be able to finish this off, no problem.
And that was definitely the one he kept his flash for, but no getting out for Bang. Excellently played. Super clean dive. Where Afrika Freaks gets the first brick, so gets the objective that keeps the gold lead with the Afrika Freaks. Huni will do some proxying, but very nice and clean fight. So important to get gold onto Kuro, who his kingdom for a Merlinomicon is kind of where he's at when it comes to dealing with this Vladimir. This is the cost of the Vlad, getting pushed in. Goes protobelt, honestly, so he can use every 40 seconds a bit more extra wave clear, and then late game in team fights, it's about getting him into the back line.
Yeah. Faker definitely going to be scary after a couple items coming through, but you know, still a ways away from that breaking point. For now, Afrika will be in the lead, 1,200 gold. Dragon has not come into contention yet. Ocean Drake did start us off here. Faker, you can see, still quite a bit of punishment in these exchanges, but the sustain is coming through. He's got the revolver. He'll have the proto belt soon, as you say. So it's definitely less oppressive than it once was.
And we were talking about in game one, Dr. Mundo versus Ashe, running at Ashe. Vladimir is honestly pretty much the same. Ghost flash proto belt at an Ashe who will get more Momordius and an early Hex Drinker, but you need lifesteal and magic resist to survive against a Vladimir, and turning around and damaging the Vladimir doesn't necessarily turn things or swing things into your control either. So 3-4 items, Vladimir, is going to be complete headache for Kramer to deal with.
But I mean, if Afrika can keep, you know, picking people off one, two at a time with that Weaver's Wall, just cutting off the rest of SK Telecom, isolating targets and burning them out, then, you know, they don't really ever necessarily have to engage into a 5v5 as long as they can get those picks before initiating an objective such as the Baron or the, you know, the later stages with the dragons, then they could just very well always have a numbers advantage against SKT.
But it's kind of a laning phase point, right? That's super strong in the laning phase of Taliyah Wall in particular. But in team fights, so much harder in a big map to be able to achieve as they want.
Wolf, and he's just going to get popped. Strangledorns won't even have a chance to knock him up. He just goes down. The damage from Kuro and Spirit ripping through him, and another kill on the board for Afrika, now 4-2.
You kind of see when the movements are so much more constricted, it's not about vision, it's so much more about going between short lanes because all turrets are up, barring the bot lane turret. This is where Afrika are strongest. When the map opens up and Ezreal and Vlad can really start splitting the map, harder for Afrika to engage their game plan, but hey, credit where credit's due. They're taking the objectives while they can, while the game is being played on their turns, and wish it was an ocean, Drake. Well, they wish it was an Infernal, probably, but they'll take an ocean, Drake.
Yeah, not the worst of things. Better we sustain it. There you go. Now an Infernal Drake will show up.
Sometimes fortunate.
Yeah. You had an Infernal Drake to start things off in game one, so that's a pretty good price to pay for having an ocean in game two. Yesterday, those guys were just getting Cloud Drakes all the time.
It's true. We were fortunate. It was White Day, though, in Korea. Yeah.
That's why.
At least it had some lore to it.
Wolf walking in looking for
Wolf remembers
vision.
This.
I'll just lose that ward that he threw down. Mooney and Marn going to be exchanging. That's on the way, but I don't think he can get in there in time to lock down this Nautilus. And even if he did, does he have the damage to kill him? Probably not.
At least Peanut is, you know, feeding off team information well. Just taking the top blue side jungle because they knew that Drake and the associated camps were being targeted by Afrika Freaks.
Let's go back for the uninitiated. White Day is the follow-up to Valentine's Day. So the female in the relationship typically gives a gift to the male.
And then there's the bachelor holiday.
Black Day, which is a month from yesterday.
Yes, 14th of April.
So you got several ones. Well, Weaver's Wall is not going to do much for Bang, but it does allow for them to go ahead and push up and take out that turret.
If you're wondering what bachelors do, they get together and eat noodles.
And then probably have some mech chew after that.
That's probably likely. I don't know if that's part of the holiday, necessarily. That's just every day in Korea. Control Ward's given them a lot of information around top lane. They're stuck there since very early in the game. Ostensibly wasn't spotted by SKT, given they haven't cleared it yet.
Yeah. For a while, but now almost all the outer turrets taken by Afrika. 16 minutes in, Marin's got that wave pushing up. The turret is dangerously low, and he's going to go for it, so should be able to take this out. Huni is a ways away. So that's going to be 3-0 as far as the turrets are concerned.
Now the 1-3-1 can be initiated by both sides. Altalia has the faster roam than the Vladimir. We will get to an item tipping point where Vlad will have all-in options on Talia. This will lead to kind of inevitable situation where Faker will probably grow in terms of CS advantage over Kuro. It's going to be a lot about making the plays on the side of Afrika. As Peanut's overextended, more so than he realizes.
Yeah. He get left on Spirit's got a lot of damage. Shield coming through from Wolf, keeping him alive. Spirit will get tethered. Oh, just barely makes it out of range over the wall. Shot Barrage, not going to find the Rengar, just barely clips the Talia. Faker going to lay down some pressure onto this turret, but you can see he just can't stay forward with those threaded volleys coming out.
Yeah, my Lenomicon is completed for Kuro. So at least able to halt some of the healing as the trades continue. What's next for the Afrika Freaks? Felt like SKT knew exactly what was next at every point in game one. Game is a lot closer in game two. Haven't been able to push up their vision lines into the SKT jungle, so they're not being able to compete for the same camps that SKT was taking away in game one. And the concern is, give Poppy and Vladimir the free farm. SKT are very happy to go even. Spirit goes for a thrilling hunt.
Just taking a cruise around that top side with Terrell. Be taken by Afrika Freaks. We'll see if they hand this over to Spirit or Marin. Probably Marin.
Either is a pretty good recipient. I think Marin will spend more time not grouped, so you get more of the bonuses.
Yeah. Oh.
Greedy. He wanted everything.
He just had to. Just felt the itch to grab up that scuttle crab real quick.
Re enters lane against Huni. fun times in top lane, but if a game is played at this pace, the early game from Afrika becomes irrelevant around 30 minutes. So it's always about what's next in competitive League of Legends, unless you have a massive scaling advantage. What you can do in the early to mid game, you can transfer your early game that sets you apart from other teams, and mid to late game is completely the purview of SK Telecom T1. They are probably the best in the world at that stage of the game. So Afrika have Force. They have Nautilus, who can show up behind with a teleport. They have Taliyah, Rengar, Ashe, even Zyra situation. It can be an engaged champion. So let's see if their vision can keep extending. It's still less neutral than it was before. It's at least in the river now. Maybe a creative Baron play at 20 minutes. Be something for them. If they can lure Faker to bot lane, that's a possibility.
That would be interesting to see. We'll try to pull something like that off. For now, I think most of the teams, both of these, will have their eyes trained on this Infernal Dragon that's going to be spawning in just under a minute.
Notice that it's a very early Executioner's Calling from Kramer. Was a lot more delayed in game one, but wasn't as necessary as it is with dealing with Vladimir. 800 gold shuts down a lot of Vlad's insane extended teamfight healing. That's a nice pickup.
I like Marin's effort trying to take away the red buff by himself. Turns out he doesn't do that very quickly. So he gets chased out of the jungle and it gets transferred over to Bang. That'll help with his kite ability for sure.
That cleave already done for Spirit. See how much shredding Kramer can do. He's had to delay his Infinity Edge, so it doesn't have the same single target damage.
SKT now spotted. Afrika have full vision over them.
They desperately want to fight right now.
And Kramer can open up with the Ash Arrow. Let's see who he's going to try to choose. Kuro in a very nice position for the Weaver's Wall to cut off the rest of SKT. Ash Arrow comes out. They find Wolf. They'll slow him up. Weaver's Wall cutting out the rest of SK Telecom from retreating back towards that Tier 2 tower. Peanut going to jump over with the collateral damage. Still up front, soaking up as much as he can. He's still relatively safe on the Vladimir. Did use the Ghost. Looks like they'll just lose Wolf for this.
SKT did not want to use extra summoner spells they didn't need to. In fact, they used none. Only Ghost from Faker is used. No flashes used on their side. That means they can at least attempt to fish around the Infernal Drake, but it probably should go over to the side of the Afrika Freaks.
Yeah, this would be way too risky to try to take this one away. Second too soon. Half
Spirit
a second
didn't have
too
smite.
Soon even. Yeah, that very well could have been a steal if delayed very slightly, but unfortunately for Bang, does not come up with it. SK Telecom will just continue to slip further behind, at least for the time being. You mentioned that 30-minute mark. It's growing closer. So we're about 21 and a half minutes in. Zonya's has completed for Faker now, so he can play a bit more up in the faces of the Afrika Freaks.
This is the part where, if you are specifically Kramer, you need a Hex Drinker, but then you kind of already itemized into a building block item in the Executioner's Calling, so you probably don't have the space to halt your Infinity Edge any longer. Ghost Flash Proto Belt Zonya's meat is the ultimate dive build from Vladimir, now that Rylai seems to be just not stat efficient enough to be picked up early. Vladimir was one of the biggest losers with the Rylai's changes, Vladimir and Cassiopeia, because the single target changes were the actual important ones. Sure, the slot efficiency in the late game, you don't have as much AP because it doesn't build out a needless large rod, but losing the single target slow was big for specifically Vladimir. Being skipped over.
And yet here we are, Vladimir kind of slingshotting his way back into the meta.
I mean, he's super good at late game teamfights. Games often go late. We don't see many 30-minute games like game one. So if you let the game extend, Vladimir is so oppressive. Staying damage, you know, Vladimir Ezreal lets you know where the meta's at. We'll see it from Kog'Maw soon. On 7.5 especially. Lethality's out the window a little bit. Jace neither picked or banned this series.
That's true, he's kind of fallen away. Haven't seen him in a little while now. Or at least his, you know, not as high of priority as he once was.
Already at Why Not Vladimir stage.
Wonderful. I want more Ahri. That's my dream. Can't get enough.
Wait for Rock's Tigers. They'll play some more Ahri, hopefully. Every time they don't, it goes bad.
Yeah.
Spotted out our SKT, but Again, this is what you don't want to see if you're in a Freak of Freaks fan. Kuro clearing a wave, and then Vladimir under no pressure, just being able to mow down the lane himself, because it just means the free items being given over. And considering diving Huni.
Death charge onto Huni, this would be risky, so is the Keeper's Verdict. Looks like they just want to get some free damage onto the turret. Kramer gets a couple shots off, but overall won't gain much ground. And he'll just rotate back over to mid. And they are keeping Huni busy. He's going to go ahead and recall. It's a fast run back, but still should give Marin a bit of time to go ahead and chip away at that turret. Actually interrupts it at the bottom side. Meanwhile, SKT pushing into this upper half of the river, looking to clear out some vision around the Baron.
Marin at least putting the Glimpse of the Void buff to good use, like you say. Holding Huni in check.
I mean, he's got an Iceborne Gauntlet.
He's got mana too, which Huni does not.
Yep.
Just being a huge jerk, but Peanut's walking towards bot lane.
Dredge line doesn't connect, but Peanut's still doing the blue. So we'll be wrapping around to go for the kill.
The Vladimir jungle means that Peanut will be taking blues, at least for the foreseeable future. Baron buff was what we talked about. At 20 minutes outside chance, Afrika would look at it. Infinity Edge done for Kramer is a big item pickup for Afrika. Now they actually have both the damage and the utility coming out from the Ash. Not sure if items ever get better for Afrika Freaks versus SKT. By that I mean the extra items for SKT, I think, will outstrip items for Afrika for the remainder of the game. The Infinity Edge, where they're at right now, is exactly where Afrika wants to fight. But finding somewhere to fight short of the Baron, probably going to be pretty tricky. It's only a Cloud Drake as the third spawn, and another one that SKT could probably afford to give up, as Marin's overstayed.
Oh, Huni's pretty far forward as well. Kuro tossed out that Weaver's Wall, but the rest of the team playing around this bottom side, looking to pick off Huni. Hit by the Ash out, dragged back in with a Dredge Line, and he goes down. So they do find it, so now no tanky frontline here for SK Telecom.
Not much lockdown left, though.
Still getting chipped away at. Now Afrika, do they try to force something up before Huni comes back up? 30 seconds on the clock. Looks like that turret in the bottom lane will be the target. Marin should be able to take this out, has the Sheen proc coming through from the Iceborne. So should be the first inner falling in favor of Afrika Freaks.
But it's definitely the softest of the objectives they could pick up. No pick into Baron when it's Huni falling, the teleport wearer. Still, it's something for Afrika. They're being completely held, and that's when things get the happiest for the SKT fans, but minor objectives also shouldn't worry them. Faker's already at 265 CS and closing in on what might be the Abyssal Scepter next. Free time with a wave. It's bad times for the Afrika Freaks.
Yep. This will be the likely itemization coming through. Go ahead and be back. We'll see the purchase coming out in just a second.
Really interested to see where Kramer goes next. Mortal Reminder.
He's opting in for more damage right now. Goes for the needlessly large rod, just going to hold on to that Negatron boat.
Interesting. Could be Death Cap, could be... We actually saw our first Ludens, Vladimir, in a long, long time, and that's, I think that was from Kuzan, so I guess that's a possibility, even if it sounds a bit curious.
Not sure if you want to model all your builds after Kuzan.
Hey man, he looked good. He could always play Vladimir. I mean, if you told me Kuzan's got a new Lissandra or Vladimir build, I'm like, sure. The other champions, I don't know.
Oh, Kuzan and his Lissandra. Saw that once.
A lot of gold on specifically Tilia and Ash for this fight. They haven't spent it yet.
Yeah, started up here, dragging down a half. How much they want to commit in for this. Weaver's Wall coming down. Huni and Peanut going to be stuck inside the pit. They go ahead, they smite away the dragon. Now Marin all by himself. Red lines away. Try to get out. Depth charge just pop up Faker and Peanut, stopping them from advancing in onto the Nautilus. SKT looks like they're just going to try to exit here as a team.
No lockdown really left for Afrika Freaks.
They're going to pinch in for this one. Huni's going to get sped up, rooted immediately.
Three-man grasping roots.
Yeah, that's going to be the end of the chase here for SK Telecom. Oh, Faker, no, he goes big, flashes in on top of Kramer. Protobelt coming down. Hemoplike ticks away, and Faker comes up with the massive kill. Zhonya is thrown down to dodge out on those Stranglethorns. Now Faker can just try to exit on the backside of the fight. Huni really far forward, tried to desperately to take out Kuro, will not be able to do so. Pays for that one with his life, but man, Faker just diving in.
That's why the three-man Grasping Roots I thought was going to be massive, the sort of thing that would be lost in translation, but you saw exactly what Faker can do already. Two clear control ults, the Ash Arrow and the Depth Charge on cooldown, and this is what Vladimir does against the meta utility carries, Ghost Flash Protobelt. It doesn't matter if it's under a turret.
Good
he has
God.
Insane burst damage. Couldn't fit in a Hex Drinker like we mentioned. Goodbye, Ash. And that's a preview of future fights. It's why I said never leave Vladimir just picking up minion waves that are pushed in by Taliyah, because it'll just keep happening more and more so. The items only get better for Vladimir.
Yeah, bit of a heartbreaker there, not able to find the kill on the Kuro for Huni. So goes down without much extra gain. Rika's still going to be in a very nice spot. Thrill the Hunt coming through. Wolf, nice flash over the wall. Save from that Ash Arrow, almost certainly would have been his death, or at least would have had to use the exhaust, which he would certainly like to hold on for a future fight. Weaver's Wall thrown down. Faker going to get cut off. Does not have the flash. Goes into the Sanguine Pool.
No Zonyas.
Not available. He's going to try to sustain as much as he can, but it's just too much. Frieka. Nice collapse by four members. They take him out.
It's probably the best time they have to take the Baron short of future kills. Hemoplague threat is gone with the Vladimir being dead. But if Rika return to the map, which pushing up lane slowly is, oh, the turn of Peanut.
Yeah, Peanut going to get locked down, popped up on the depth charge. He gets taken out. Now that the Graves is eliminated, 45 seconds on his death timer. That should be the turn on the Baron for Frieka. Huni will go ahead, split bottom, take out that tier one tower, but that's just a pittance compared to snatching up this Baron.
They need to finish the Baron. They're against three members. It looks like SKT aren't even going to try to put up a contest.
They're going to try to just get some turrets in. Now they're in danger of getting collapsed on.
Can they stop mid lane from going down? They can. This is really good from the side of a Freak of Freaks.
Yep.
With Vladimir alive, Baron is always a super huge risk. But Vladimir being dead was the key to that start from a Freak. It's a good shot calling. Vladimir didn't have Flash, didn't have Zonyas. Was, for once, a free kill, which he will not be for the majority of this game. Let's see what they can do with the Baron. Breaking the base is honestly the minimum for a Freaker.
How about Redemption come down? Not entirely certain why. But Wolf tossed it out under the turret.
Zoning Redemption.
Yeah. Stay away, Martin. But one turret is all that SKT was able to pick up at the bottom lane. That's their first turret of the game, 30 minutes in. So definitely a complete reversal compared to game 1 and 2.
He's going to run at Kuro. I heard a ghost being popped.
Yeah,
that was
ahead.
By Kuro.
They at least get the summoner spell away from him. So a minor victory. But SKT, they need so much more. We'll get a replay here of Peanut getting caught.
I assume Peanut got greedy with recall, but I wasn't sure. He walked up first.
It's just going to be a death charge with a dredge line.
And a dredge line first. Yeah, went for it there. Got onto Peanut.
Yeah, I mean, it's good on Martin. You know, didn't overcommit for the kill onto Faker in the top lane. They knew that they had him cut off. He had no flash, so he didn't have to use the ultimate. And then he's able to just utilize that to take out Peanut, and that leads to them getting a Baron. And now Afrika want to tack more objectives onto that list as they push in for this inner turret.
Spirit's trying to do the team thing and build the locket himself because Tucson's going for more damage. No locket yet, though. Faker's looking for teamfight access. He still has Kramer on his mind. Still can't take him out in an instant.
Elliot hip turret going to be targeted by Afrika. Barn taking up in the front line. Through Shaparaj comes out, finds a little bit of damage onto a couple members of Afrika.
A lot of unspent gold. 2,500 this time on Marin. Remember, when your gold lead's only 7,000, if you have 5,000 of it in the bank, so the gold lead's even smaller than it appears. Trying to use that Baron buff, though.
Yeah. Well, the recalls come through. We'll return fairly quickly. Baron's almost 75% of the way completed. So they still have a little bit of time to utilize that. They want to just go try pushing up in this top lane.
It's all about those picks.
Still the Hunt from Spirit leaps forward, trying to get on the Peanut. He quick draws away, but now he's going to get cut off by this Weaver's Wall, targeted out by Kuro, and very well may fall. Redemption coming down. Is it enough to keep him alive? Yes, it is. Right on the backside, it comes through, and Spirit gets popped, stunned into the wall by Huni. And they finish him off, and Peanut barely makes it out with his life.
Yeah, Kuro pulled off because of the teleport coming through. Spirit stayed one-track mindedly, and that means someone falls. And with minion waves so well prepped by SKT, pushing into top, pushing into bottom, there will be no other objectives gained during this Baron buff power play.
Nicely done by SKT, even when they're 7,000 gold behind. Still making the correct moves. Let's see Marin. He's not plus by everything going on. He's got so many shields. Oh, that is...
That's bad.
That's bad times if your Faker pops his Onias. There won't be any collapse on him for now, but not having the cooldown up for a fight that very well could be coming in the near future is going to be very dangerous here for this Vladimir.
I don't know if I've ever seen a Faker Fat Finger before.
Ah, that's a tongue twister.
Say it three times fast.
Cloudrake now going to be pushed over to a Freak of Freaks, whereas they might have been able to contest that if Faker had popped the Zonias.
Cloudrake's actually pretty damn relevant, specifically Faker, being able to Ghost Flash at the Ash, so it's a bit of... I managed to say that, so speaking of tongue twists, I'm doing all right here, Achilles. Just having the extra movement speed for the Ash opens up distance, forces the extra commit of something like the Flash. There's the Hex Drinker. This is definitely a more Malmordius game. You'd love to go higher damage in your build path, but Kramer has already felt the might of Faker. Sliding into the back line.
Now every time you talk, I'm listening for more rhymes to come out.
I did intentionally say sliding into the back line also.
Rap God, Papa Smithy.
I mean, it's Ash versus Vladimir. What's there to say? The Rivers, something, something. Anyway.
Oh, dear.
Spirit keeps hunting, but last hunt not closed. Slowed the game a bit on the side of SKT. Gave them even more time to farm up, waiting to see that needs large rod item from Faker. Zonya's still on cooldown for about 15 seconds.
And now they're going to be trying to defend this turret. Marn pushing forward. Not going to get rooted. Has that dredge line to take him out.
Spirit.
Drop Raj, does clip Spirit. He's down to about half HP, but they can't chase in too much harder than that. Turret still stands, but the waves are crashing. The Freaking Freaks are still very comfortable to stick around.
Minions and bot are not pushing for a Freaker, but everything else working for them. There's the Weaver's Wall.
Yeah, Weaver's Wall coming through. Hoodie and Faker are going to be stuck under the turret. Marin here tanking up, has that GA ready to go as well. Their turret goes down. Ashera won't connect onto anybody, but Faker gets rooted up. He goes quite low, so now he has to transfuse his way back up. Full HP before he can engage in these fights. Maybe even just recall, but another turret goes over to Afrika. Keep pushing this advantage 6-1 in that regard. SK Telecom have only gotten one turret this entire game.
That ward is the MVP, Achilles.
It's
still alive.
For so long.
It's probably been there since 4 minutes. I wish we could go back. I don't have the ability to rewind time.
It's been almost a half hour, if not already.
Just the most high value 75 gold you ever seen?
How has no one walked in there?
I mean, that's not really a brush you path into that often. During that kind of fight around it, you would have thought someone walk in, but the previous 28 minutes, you could understand it.
Sure.
That's the one where Koma's ripping out his hair, being like, I know we've won the first game, but this ward!
We would have won this game if it wasn't for that damn ward!
Oh, Faker?
Faker?
Faker, kill it.
Faker,
just kill it.
Faker, please.
Just kill it.
Faker, no.
No, Faker,
no, Faker, no!
Well, I'm sure he knows it's there. I'd like to come up with a flowery explanation of he didn't want to kill it because then there's time on the other side of the map for him, but that's he probably just didn't
Yeah,
see
I don't
it.
Think he noticed it.
He didn't ping it out either. Anyways, the ward lives,
well,
so...
Koma's bald now. He's ripped out all his hair.
He needs that hair. He's still on his search for a wife, Achilles.
Yeah, I know. He's already been getting ridiculed on his live stream for his hairline. Poor guy.
Yeah, poor three-time world champion coach. Just real tough life for Koma. Well, that was the most excitement we've had all game.
Yeah. Pretty much. Oh, man. This is going back to like, the old seasons where everyone would just cheer for the wards getting killed over and over again.
That was never a thing in Korea, but... That would have been a Bible thump ward, I think.
I remember Worlds in North America seasons ago. It would happen quite a bit. There's some interesting moments from those Worlds broadcasts. Faker. Audience members doing things in the background that they shouldn't be doing.
I'm sure Faker and Combs are saying, don't worry, guys. I've almost got 6 items, which is still true. Been sitting on a lot of items for a long time. We still... Do not know where the nearest large rod is going. Imagining death cap at this point. A bit late for Ludens.
Yeah, probably.
Now, if Afrika can get a second Baron, I think they can close. I mean, to me, it's how do you take Baron when specifically Faker is alive, which kind of eludes me.
Yeah. I mean, Wave Clear is not that fantastic from the side of SK Telecom if they have Baron-empowered minions.
Faker somehow, in a losing game, has 3,000 gold in the bank because Faker. He's pinged out, so they know he's backed. Comes back with the death cap we were alluding to. 9,000 gold lead. 8,000, I guess, more accurately. It's a big deep teleport.
TP going onto the ward. Peanut's already dead. Kuro coming up with the kill, and now Marin wrapping around from above.
They want now. He slowed down, loses the home guards. They'll back away. This needs to be Baron.
That's going to be Baron. Yeah, 50 seconds on the clock for Peanut. Oh. It would be a miracle steal for SKT.
It'll be a Baron stop, but remember, Faker is fearsome with everything up. He can solo get 50% HP down on every member. Talia Wall will slow them, though.
Yeah, TP's coming into the pit. Hoonie, they're going to try to commit into this one. He does have the Keeper's Verdict. He's going to charge it up, but the Baron already goes over. He boots Spirit away.
Faker.
Very barely, though. Hoonie dashing in. Faker going in, throws down that Hemo Plague, but still gets popped. Has to go straight into the zone. He just can't come up with a single kill yet. Takes a ton of damage from the seismic jump, and will get picked off. Koro comes up with a kill. Now Hoonie trying to exit, flashes away on the top side of the pit, but he's going to get his GA popped in the meantime. Bang and Wolf hiding around this bottom side of the pit. Get a lot of damage through onto Spear, but they cannot finish him off. And that is just going to be utter devastation for SK Telecom. Baron buff going over to Afrika. They don't lose anybody, and now they could very well push in to finish off the game.
Really decisive stuff from Afrika. We wondered how they would take Baron, but the Weaver's Wall continues to be the tool that stops SKT from being able to react in the sort of timely fashion they are known for. Gold lead balloons over 10,000. For the first time this game, with where the items are at. One more teamfight wipe. Hell, three or four picks, and this could be game for Afrika. Remember, the backup win condition is online. Elder Dragon has spawned. They have three stacks of Elder Drakes, although Marin is all alone.
But he'll be K.
Buying time for that Elder Dragon.
He still hasn't even lost the Guardian Angel, so he is in such a strong spot. Yeah, Elder Dragon just going to get shredded through by Afrika Freak. Three stacks going forward for them, plus Baron buff, one of those stacks being Infernal Afrika. If they can't close out the game with this, then they definitely don't deserve to win the series. Marin will get pinched on. Baker and Wolf wrapping up to have that tether to lock him down, but the shields are just so massive.
This could be another meanwhile at moment. Look at the bot side of the map. The mini map is the true story here. SKT taking forever to even try and kill Marin.
Yeah, can't even pop the Guardian Angel yet again, and now an assault on two fronts here, mid lane and bottom lane. Going down, the Freakins consistently apply pressure. Spirit jumping in, facing the Sand, forcing the Sand Queen pull out from Faker. So just losing even more HP. Bottom turret falls, mid will follow suit here. A couple more hits will take it out, and Marin's got the wave ready to go in top. You can just have to think that SKT are going to get strangled out of this game.
So Weaver's Wall once again. Peanut has flash.
Jordan's thrown down. Get popped up, is able to back himself into that corner, but that's going to be all three inhibitors falling. SKT, can they do anything? Faker poking in from the sidelines. Hoonie wasn't in range to initiate a fight. Now SK Telecom. It's a matter of time, you'd have to say, before this game ends. Massive gold lead over to Afrika, now stretched to above 15,000.
Somehow SKT has been perennially frustrated in getting into fights. Specifically, Faker has ghosted but not had access to a fight multiple times. Weaver's Wall, one of the big MVPs. The itemization is finally there. Abyssal Scepter, more Malmordius. The locket coming through from Spirit doing the team thing on the Rengar rather than looking to solo carry like someone like Crash. Still is a team fight you see where somehow Faker and Bang with their sustained damage can clean up, but when they're wearing Elder Dragon, when they're wearing the Baron, it looks far away, and Hoonie's caught.
Yeah, way out of position. He's going to get locked down. Big Keeper's Verdict might just keep him alive, but Kuro is there to try to follow up. He does not have a flash to get over the wall, and he will go down. Meanwhile, Faker, getting popped up by the depth charge, goes really low, goes into the Sanguine Pool, pushing forward, trying to get some HP back, but he just can't do it. Kuro comes up with a double kill, and now Afrika, with two members dead on the side of SK Telecom, will be pushing in, looking to end the game. Dredgeline forward onto Bang. Catches him up, forces out both of those summoner spells. The turrets are now collapsing. Peanut flashing over the Weaver's Wall, trying to keep himself alive, but there's nothing that SKT can do to defend the base. They will lose this game too, and Afrika Freaks will keep their hopes alive And they'll be taking us a game number three.
And it was so disciplined from Afrika Freaks. They did it so cleanly at the end of the game when they were fruitlessly following Marin. It felt like Afrika's chase on Faker in game one. So funny how this game can kind of mirror what happened in game one with different teams. Spirit comes back in and they look super clean. No brain fades in the early game for SKT to exploit. And the Vladimir pick, which has never been a speciality of Faker, does very little. Faker was trivial in this game, honestly. A bit like Dr. Mundo from Marin in game one. And this is a series that keeps giving. I'm really excited to see what game three gives us, because we've had the surprise picks. We've had the control display from both teams. And now we get one game to decide if Afrika can double match win against SKT in spring season and really cement themselves as a contender for spring.
Really good stuff here for Afrika. But now